to discuss about biaxial bending. Example would be purlin design. Okay, so from the previous discussion that we had, we only considered uniaxial bending, and that would be bending about its major axis. So this time we're going to consider two-axis bending. That would be the bending about the major axis. At the same time, what would be the effect of bending about the minor axis? And that is applicable for purlins. So let's say I have this beam section, okay, an I-shaped section. So if the load is applied here vertically downward, so the beam experiences bending about the major axis. Then if the load is applied laterally on this section, maybe it could be coming from a seismic or wind load, so the beam will deflect or will experience bending about the minor axis naman. So if these two axis bending occurs on the beam, so we have to analyze or design it based from the provisions on biaxial bending. So this is applicable for the design of purlins kasi, as we know, purlins are placed at the top of the top chord. So if this is the top chord of the truss, so purlins are placed on top of the top chord like that. So as you can see, yung purlins naka-inclined. So if the purlin is naka-inclined siyang ganyan, and considering that the load are gravity, vertically downward, so if you will consider the components of this gravity load, it would have a component that will cause bending about the major axis in this direction, and it will also be resolved in this direction that will cause bending about the minor axis of the beam. So for purlin design, purlins are designed based on biaxial bending. Okay. Okay, for biaxial bending, this would be the interaction equation that we need to satisfy. No? So the first term is the interaction equation considering bending on the major axis. That would be mux divided by phi for bending, m and x. Plus the second term would be bending about the minor axis or the y-axis, and that would be capital muy divided by the resistance factor phi sub b m and y. So take note that the numerators mux and muy are the factored load moment about the x and the y axis respectively. So basically, the numerators can be calculated based from the given factored loads, usually the maximum moment on the beam. While on the denominator, we have the m and x and the m and y. This would be the nominal moment strength for x and y axis respectively. For capital M and X, this is the nominal moment strength for x-axis bending. So if you could recall dun sa previous discussion natin for M and X, so first you have to check for the compactness of the section. The next is you have to check for the lateral support condition of the beam. And next is you have to solve for the C sub B. Then just follow the procedure on how to compute for the M and X. Okay, so ito yung medyo mahabang procedure for the major axis bending. Now, for the minor axis bending, which is the M and Y, nominal moment strength for the Y axis, medyo mas simple lang siya, mas mabilis. Basically, the M and Y is dependent on the compactness of the section lang. So, if the section is compact, for this one, this would be the M and Y value. That would be plastic moment, MPY, which would be equal to Fy times Zy. Take note, we have to use the Zy property of the section this time. And the limit would be 1.6 of Fy Sy. So this would be the limit for the plastic moment on minor axis bending. 1.6 of Fy times Sy. Now, if the section is non-compact section naman, so we have to use this one naman. Okay, so this one. For non-compact section, the M and Y shall be equal to M plastic about Y minus M plastic Y minus 0.7 of FYSY multiplied by the ratio of the lambda minus lambda P divided by the lambda R minus lambda P. So if you could still recall, the lambdas are the compactness parameters. Okay, so you just recall the width limiting ratios. these are the lambdas. Okay, so again, yung MPY, that is the plastic moment strength about the y-axis. And yung FYSY, that is actually the yield moment for the y-axis. Okay, so di bali, yun lang yung bago dito, no? Yung MNY. The rest would be similar to the previous discussions. Okay, so if you will take a look of the case of the purlin, let's say you have this roof framing system. Okay, so we have this truss, then you have the top cord there. Then as you can see, we have channel purlins placed at the joints. So these are the joints of the top cord. Usually, purlins are placed at the joints, no? On both sides of the top cord of the truss. So for this figure, as you can see, I am using a channel section used as a purlin. So ito yung elevation view. Tapos yung top view naman ito. Okay? So this would be the span of the truss, ST. Yan, ito yung pinaka-span ng truss natin. And this would be the spacing. So from here hanggang dito, yan yung spacing naman truss. Spacing ng between ng truss. Okay? So, kung yung truss natin is ito, yung purlin natin naka-perpendicular. So, sabihin, yung length ng purlin natin would be equal to the spacing of the trusses. Ulitin ko. The length of the purlin will just be corresponding to the spacing between trusses. Okay? So as you can see from this figure, sag rods are placed at third points. Ibig sabihin, if the spacing between trusses is L, and that L is also the length of the purlin, at L over 3, sag rods are placed. So this is L over 3. L over 3, L over 3, and this is L over 3. Or sometimes, pagka L over 3 kasi at third points, di bali dalawang sets of sag rods are placed sa dalawang set ng sag rods. Kapag gusto mo maglagay lang ng sag rods sa midspan at L over 2, pwede rin. Isang set ng sag rods lang ang lalabas. Okay, sag rods are being placed or used to address the lateral, it serves as a lateral support dun sa purlin natin. Kasi since naka-inclined yung purlin natin, so there is a big probability that the purlin would experience lateral buckling. And to prevent that, you have to provide for a lateral support in the presence of sag rods. So in terms of truss loadings, so ganito yung magiging loads natin, no? So first, we will be considering the gravity loads. When I say gravity loads, the direction of the loads are vertically downward. Those gravity loads would come from the dead and the live load. Yung dead load consists of the roof material itself. Okay, so yung bubong mismo na nakapatong sa purlin. So that is considered as dead load. Tapos another dead load is the self weight of the purlin itself. Yan, so dead load din yun. Gravity load din yun. Tapos yung live load naman dyan is the roof live load. Okay, roof live load. When I say roof live load, basically, nasa code naman yan kung paano mag-compute ng roof live load. Sa project nyo rin, ganun din. Makikita nyo rin naman yan sa code kung paano mag-compute ng roof live load. Basically, the roof live load is dependent on the slope of the truss. Kapag ka masyado matarik yung bubong mo, so malaki yung theta, yung angle mo rito, diba? Matarik, so sabihin, ang tendency ng live load, mag-slide down lang. So, kumbaga, yung possibility na mag-stay yung live load dun sa bubong mo, maikli lang, mabilis lang. Hindi sila mag-stay na matagal kasi masyadong matarik yung bubong mo. So, sabihin, the larger the value of your theta, yung theta is the inclination of the slope, inclination of the top cord with respect to the horizontal. The larger the theta, the smaller would be your roof live load. Tapos, also, roof live load is based from the tributary loaded area, yung area ng bubong. The larger the area ng bubong, the smaller would be the roof live load. Kasi syempre, nade-divide yung roof live load for a bigger area. That's why lumiliit yung magnitude niya. Yung roof live load basically refers to those anything that could be present during the maintenance of the roofing. Halimbawa, may aakyat sa bubong mo, no, magkukumpune or magre-repair or something. So those things are charged to roof live load. Okay, so hindi yan yung mga pusa or kung sino man or daga na nandiyan sa ibaba ng bubong mo. So very small naman yung ganung weight na yon, no? So basically it refers to the anything that could be present on top of your roofing, especially during maintenance. So yun yung roof live load. So again, yung dead load tsaka roof live load are all vertically downward. Tapos, another possible load na pwede maging present doon sa roof natin would be the wind load. Okay, ang wind load naman, ang direction ng wind load is always perpendicular to the surface. So kapag ang, ito yung top chord mo, okay, pagka tumama yung wind load sa top chord mo, naka-perpendicular siya. Okay, so ito yung roof surface, so 90 degrees, nandun yung direction ng roof, ng wind load. Kapag yung roof, yung wind load naman is tumama sa wall, kunwari ang wall mo is vertical, ito yung wind load mo, so perpendicular din. Kung vertical wall yan, so ang wind load mo would be horizontal. So parati siyang 90 degrees, lagi siyang perpendicular yung direction ng wind load. Ang wind load could be pressure, pagka pressure, sabihin patulak. Katulad dito, windward ang tawag doon. Windward. Pagka, okay, sorry. If the wind load comes from the left, kunwari ganyan. If the wind load comes from the left, galing sa left, papunta sa kanan, yung unang tatamaan or dadapuan ng wind load, ang tawag doon is the windward side. Windward side. Kumbaga yun yung pinaka-entry point. Kung ito yung bubong, ang entry point ng wind load, ang tawag doon, windward side. Tapos yung exit point ng wind load, ang tawag doon naman is the leeward side. Okay? So, entry point, windward side. Yung exit point, yun yung leeward side. Okay? So, kapag ang wind load naman ang galing sa, on this direction, galing sa kanan, so ito naman yung magiging windward side. Yung exit point naman niya, yun naman yung leeward side. Now, ang leeward side, parati siyang suction. Okay, ulitin ko. So, yung leeward side, parati siyang suction. Ang ibig sabihin ng suction is, hinihigop niya. Ang direction ng wind load is away from the surface parati, suction. Sa windward side, pwede siya maging pressure. Pag sinabi kong pressure, patulak. Or pwede siya maging suction. Okay, so yan yung sa windward side. Pwede siyang i-pressure, pababa. Pwede rin siyang suction, pahigop. Depende siya sa inclination ng topward with respect to horizontal sa theta. Kapag yung theta mo masyadong maliit, ibig sabihin ng maliit na theta, masyadong flat yung bubong mo. Okay? Pagka masyadong flat yung bubong mo, yung windward side usually nagiging suction. Kaya nga may nililipad ng mga bubong. Kasi suction yung windward, suction din yung leeward. So pareha silang suction, kaya posibleng lumipad yung bubong. Pero kapag yung bubong mo has malaking theta value, malaking theta means medyo steep, matarik yung bubong mo. Pagka matarik ang bubong mo, ang windward side mo, usually magiging pressure yan, patulak. Pero yung leeward side mo, kahit anong klakong matarik man o flat yung bubong mo, parati siyang suction naman ang leeward side mo. Kaya pansinin mo sa Batanes, malakas ang wind load. When I say wind load, I'm referring to bagyo. Ah. Hindi ito yung basta hangin lang na dumadaan sa area. It refers to bagyo talaga. So high intensity of wind velocity. So sa Batanes, diba, mataas ang wind load doon. Kaya pansinin mo, para mo ma-avoid yung mga nagliliparang bubong doon, ang karamihan ng mga bubong doon is medyo matarik yung slope. Para hindi siya mag-suction. Para siya mag-pressure. Pressure means pababa. Kasi pagka nag-suction, lilipa rin siya. Kaya ginagawa nila is matarik yung slope para maging pressure. At the same time, pansinin mo, they're more of gravity. No? Kasi ang wind load, syempre, ang tendency niyan talaga is, yung bad effect niyan is, lipa rin. Okay, so yun yung direction ng gravity load, pababa, vertically downward. Tapos ang direction ng wind load naman is normal to the surface. So, kung idodrawing ko yung free body diagram ng purlin, eto siya. Okay, so from my left figure, you can see there my purlins, no? So, we have the purlins there. Tapos, series of purlin eh. So, if I call S to be the spacing between purlins, so kung i-consider ko yung isang purlin ko dito, tributary width would be kalahati dito, tributary width kalahati rin dito. So, basically, ang tributary width ng isang purlin would be S then. So, kadalasan, ang binibigay na load natin, roof load. Pag sinabing roof load, that is expressed in Pascal or kilopascal. Pascal is Newton per square meter. Square meter. Okay, ang kilopascal is kilonewton per square meter. Okay, square meter siya. So, ibig sabihin yung roof load is roof area load. It is an area load. Area load. So, para mo ma-convert yung area load to a uniform load, ibig sabihin, kapag kakinonsider mo yung isang purlin na lang, isang pirasong purlin na lang, so you have to consider yung uniform load dito sa length niya, diba? Hindi na siya magiging area, sa halip it would be a uniform load. So ang gagawin mo is, you're going to multiply lang yung roof load mo, W, capital W, multiply mo lang siya ng tributary width. And the tributary width would be the spacing. And that would give you the small W, and that would be the uniform load carried by one purlin. Okay? Now, so meron na tayo sa isang purlin. So, ganito yun. Looking at the figure on the right side, so, yan na yung free body diagram ng purlin natin. Okay, so, una, yung self-weight ng purlin, nag-a-apply siya, nag-a-act siya dun sa centroid ng purlin. Kaya, nandito yung self-weight ng purlin. Nasa centroid. Okay. Pero yung gravity loads, etong gravity load na to, it would be the dead load plus the roof live load. Yung dead load dito refers to the roofing, yung bubong. Diba? Siyempre, yung bubong, nakamount naman yan sa ibabaw mismo ng purlin. Eh. Kaya ang point of application yan, nasa ibabaw ng purlin. Ganon din yung roof live load. Ang roof live load, nasa ibabaw ng bubong. Eh. So, ang point of application ng gravity load natin is nasa ibabaw ng purlin. Kaya nandito yung gravity load. Nakahiwalay yung self-weight. Okay? Samantalang yung wind load naman, as what I've said, diba, ang direction niya is always normal or perpendicular to the direction to the surface. So if the surface is naka-inclined, so ang wind load natin 90 degrees. So basically, these are the loads. We have the self-weight of the purlin, nasa centroid. Yung gravity loads, that would be dead load and the roof live load, nasa ibabaw ng purlin, vertical downward. Tapos yung wind load, nasa ibabaw din ng purlin, which is normal naman or perpendicular to the surface of the node. Then you have this theta. Yung theta again is the slope of the top chord with respect to the horizontal. If this is theta, ito rin yung lalabas na theta rito. Okay? So if we consider the gravity loads, okay, so this would be the gravity loads, so W sub G, and that would be coming from the dead load plus the live load. Dead load plus the live load times the spacing. So, itong dead load and live load na to would be an area load. Okay? This would be a roof load expressed in Pascal or kilopascal. Tapos, pagka minultiply mo ng spacing, yun yung tributary width, magiging siyang kilonewton per meter na lang yung gravity load. Tapos, yung wind load naman natin, that would be the wind pressure. So, maybe it would be in Pascal or kilopascal times mo rin siya ng spacing, yung tributary width para ma-consider mo yung isang purlin. Tapos yung CW, that is the coefficient for the wind load. It could be a coefficient for pressure load or it could be a coefficient for suction. So usually it is given based from the calculation of the wind load. Okay, so basically alam mo dapat yan ha. So again, yung gravity load, yung wind load, tsaka yung self-weight na yan, these are uniform loads. So, these are all uniform loads. Uniform loads, yan. So, kapag ni-resolve natin yan sa components, para the normal load component would be W sub N, ito. Normal component. And that would be the wind load. So, normal component na yung wind load, diba? Tapos, kukuhain natin yung normal component ng gravity load. That would be gravity load times cosine of theta. At saka yung normal component din ng self-weight ng purlin times cosine of theta. Okay, so kumbaga, yun yung component ng mga vertical loads when it comes to, kung ito yung section natin, di ba yung gravity load tsaka self-weight, ganito yung direction. Kukuha natin yung yung component on this direction. Kasi this component of the load will cause bending about the major axis. Yung normal component will cause bending about the major axis. Samantalang kapag kukunin natin yung tangential component, at dito siya, okay, yung tangential component will be gravity load plus self-weight sine theta. Ito yun. Yung pangalawa, no? So this would be the tangential component, W sub T naman. So that would be sine theta of the gravity load tsaka sine theta of the self-weight. Yung wind load, wala nang component dun sa tangential kasi ang wind load is pure normal. Okay? So yan. So sabihin, from all these given loads, nai-resolve natin siya into normal load tsaka yung tangential load. So dalawa na yung uniform loads natin. Again, yung normal uniform load, ito yung uniform load dito sa ibabaw ng beam. Tapos yung tangential load naman, ito naman yung uniform load dito sa on this direction naman. It will cause bending about the y-axis. Okay. So let us now identify yung mga mu, mux tsaka muy. These are the critical or the maximum moment. So pagka nagde-design or nag-analyze tayo ng SAGRAD, we only idealize purlins to be simple beams or simply supported beam. Where in fact, in reality, pagka in-idealize mo yung mga purlins, di ba? Pagka, di ba, maraming truss, truss 1, truss 2, truss 3, tapos yung purlin mo nasa ibabaw ng mga top chord, ng mga trusses na yon, di ba, yung purlin naman yun, dire-diretso naman yun eh. So, in reality, the purlin should be idealized as a continuous beam with continuous supports, di ba? Supposedly, dapat ganun yung analysis. Kaya lang, to make things simpler, para mas simplified yung analysis natin, instead of considering continuous beam yung purlin, gagawin natin is puputulin na lang natin siya per span. We will just idealize it as a simple beam. Alam natin, syempre, mas madaling mag-analyze ng simple beam kaysa sa continuous beam kasi ang continuous beam, indeterminate yan to higher degree. So, mahirap mag-analyze kapag ka-continuous beam. So, what we're going to do here is we will just idealize purlins as simple beam. So, yung span niya is yung L. Okay? So, as you can see, pagka x-axis bending, ang concern natin, ito yung purlin natin, okay? So, yung x-axis bending is due to the load here. And yung load natin dito is yung normal, W sub N. Okay? Yung normal component, W sub N. So, yun yung figure natin dito sa left side, no? So, yung unang figure natin is, we have the purlin without SAGRAD. Okay, so kung walang SAGRAD, due to WN, anong maximum moment about X? Edi WN L square over 8. Simple beam with uniform load. So madali lang, WL square over 8. So ito yun. This is the maximum moment, okay, on the purlin. WN L square over 8. Now, yung pangalawang figure is kapag may SAGRAD na sa midspan. Kung mapapansin mo, yung SAGRAD nandito, yung nasa gitna, yung may X. Okay, kung ito yung purlin natin, yung SAGRAD natin, nandito siya nakapwesto. Kung midspan siya, kung ito yung L, maging L over 2. So, nandito yung SAGRAD. Yan, perpendicular sa screen. Nandito sa harap, tapos meron din tuloy sa likod. So, nandun yung SAGRAD. Now, kung may SAGRAD tayo sa midspan, ito yung W sub N, diba? Pagka nag-bending siya about the major axis, may effect ba yung SAGRAD dito? Meron bang effect yung SAGRAD dito kapag nag-bending tayo about X? Diba wala? So, sabihin, yung lateral support na to na nakalagay dito sa gilid, when we consider bending about the major X-axis, wala siyang effect. Still, what would be the maximum moment? E di, ang maximum moment mo pa rin, kahit may SAGRAD at midspan, would be WN L square over 8 pa rin. So, pares pa rin. Ito pa rin. No? Pares lang siya ng una. Ganun din kahit magkaroon ka ng SAGRAD at third points. Ito yung pangatlong figure natin. May SAGRAD ka sa third points. SAGRAD at third points meaning that is at L over 3, L over 3, tsaka may L over 3. So kahit magkaroon ka ng SAGRADs dyan, dalawang set na yun. No? So dito isa, tsaka dito rin is another isa at L over 3, L over 3, L over 3. Pagka kinonsider mo yung bending about the major axis, nandito yung WN, normal, So ang bending mo pa rin pag ganun, wala pa ring effect yung mga sagrads na nakalagay rito. Therefore, the maximum moment about X is still Wn L square over 8. So what I'm saying is, ang sagrad, wala siyang effect sa pagkuha ng maximum moment about the major X axis. Okay, major X axis. So yun yung X axis bending. Now, lipat tayo dun sa mga figure sa kanan na part. Okay, so yung kanan na part naman is Y axis bending. So yung Y axis bending, ihiga ko to para makita nyo. So nakaganyan na yung beam ko. So anong tawag dun sa load natin dito? Pagka nag-bend siya ng ganyan, that is y-axis bending, diba? So, ano yung tawag dun sa load natin dito? Diba ito yung W tangential, WT. Okay, so yun yung makikita mo sa drawing. No? So, ito yung W sub T na. Tapos, as you can see sa figure, nakahiga na yung section. Kasi we're considering bending about the y-axis. Now, pag walang sagrad, without sagrad, edi walang tumutuko dito sa gitna. Ito yung sagrad, yung ballpin kong pula. Diba? So, walang sagrad, tapos may W tangential dito. So pagka nag-bend dyan, anong maximum moment? E di parang simple beam with uniform load. So ang maximum moment natin is W tangential L square over 8. Or this is the same with W tangential capital L square over 8. Kasi pagka without sagrad, yung small letter L natin is just the same with capital L. Pagka walang sagrad. So, yun yung definition ng small letter L. It's just the same with capital L. Now, paano pagka may sagrads na sa midspan? Okay, eto na. May sagrad na tayo sa midspan. So, niredefine ko yung small letter L. Okay, niredefine ko ulit bago na yung small letter L dito pagka may sagrad sa midspan. I redefine small letter L to be capital L over 2. So, yung capital L is the full length. So, kung may sagrad ako dito sa midspan, yung sagrad na yon dito, considering bending about y-axis, tumutukod. Diba? So, ito yung W tangential sa ibabaw eh. Tapos, may sagrad ako sa ilalim. So, iksabihin yung sagrad sa ilalim, para siyang tumutukod. Tumutukod means para siyang suporta. So, kung i-analyze natin yung beam with respect to y-axis bending, yung lateral support dito, yung sagrad dito sa ilalim, nagsiserve siya as parang support. Kaya kung mapapansin mo, meron na akong parang interior support dito. And that makes the beam indeterminate na to first degree, diba? Indeterminate beam yan, para siyang continuous beam na eh. May end support ka, dulo-dulo, tapos yung sagrad, nagsiserve siya as support, so para siyang continuous beam na. Indeterminate to first degree. So hindi siya madaling isolve yung maximum moment. So paano mo makuha yung maximum moment yan? E di gagamit ka ng theory of structures. So siguro pwede kang pinakamabilis dito yung three-moment equation. Pagka nag three moment equation ka rito, the maximum moment na makukuha mo rito sa continuous beam due to the sagrad support at the midspan, the maximum moment would be this one, W tangential L square over 8. Okay? So, ito yun. W small letter L square over 8. Or kung gagamitan siya ng malaking capital L, malaking L, W tangential, what is small letter L? Diba? Capital L over 2 square over 8. So, pagka sinimplify mo yan, that would be WT capital L square over ilan? So, 2 raised to 2 is 4. 4 times 8 is 32. So, yan din yung maximum moment natin kapag ka may sagrad at midspan. Kapag ka small letter L, it's WL square over 8. Pagka capital L ang gagamitin mo, it's WL square over 32. So just be careful in using small letter L or capital L. They're just the same. Okay? So, tapos, ito namang ano, ito namang tension sa sagrad na makikita mo rito, yung 5 over 8 WT times L, this would be the tension on the sagrad. Kasi sagrad nga yung tumutukod, diba? So yung 5 over 8 na yan, na-solve ko yan by 3-moment equation din. Pagka na-solve mo yung maximum moment, yung WL square over 32 by applying statics, makukuha mo yung support reaction sa gitna. And yung support reactions na yun, yun yung 5 over 8 WT over L. Gagamitin mo naman yun mamaya kapag ka nag-design ka ng sagrad. Kasi ang sagrads are considered as tension member. So yung tensile force doon na gagamitin mo for the sagrad is yun, yung 5 over 8 WT times L. Okay? So again, yung maximum moment natin dito is yung WT capital L square over 32 is actually located under the support. Nandun yung maximum moment. Okay? Now, yung pangatlong case natin is kapag yung sag rods are placed at third points. Okay, third points. So pag sinabing third points, niredefine ko uli yung small letter L this time to be the capital L over 3. So ito na yung small letter L, that is capital L over 3. Now, with respect to major axis, so again, diba kanina, walang effect yung lateral support, walang effect yung sag rod considering bending about X. Ang magiging effect niya na lang is kapag bending about Y. So nasaan yung lateral support, nasaan yung sag rod kapag bending about Y? Hindi ba't nandito sila at tutukod sila? Dalawang parang magiging supports. So ito yung mga sag rods natin this time. No? So nagkaroon tayo ng support dito, tsaka support dito, kasi nagkaroon ng sag rod. Again, for this case, bending about Y, naging continuous beam siya with tatlong spans. And this is indeterminate to second degree. Okay, so indeterminate to second degree na yung beam. So paano mo malalaman yung maximum moment yan? E di mag 3-3 moment equation ka, o kaya slope deflection method, o kaya gusto mo MDM. So any method will do. Okay, so I think pinakamabilis dyan yung 3 moment equation, magiging 2 equations with 2 unknowns, malalaman mo that the maximum moment are located at under the supports, under the sag rods. And the magnitude is actually W tangential L square over 10. Or kapag ka-in-express mo ito in terms of capital L, that would be WT. Ano yung small letter L dito? Diba? L over 3. L over 3. So capital L over 3 square over 10. Over 10. So pagka sinimplify mo yan, that would be WT capital L square over ilan yan? So 3 times 3 raised to 2 is 9. 9 times 10 is 90. Kaya over 90. Pares lang yan. Kapag in terms of small letter L, it's WL square over 10. Kapag in terms of capital L, it's WL square over 90. Okay? So, para mas madaling matandaan lahat ng formula na to, gamitin nyo yung small letter L. Gamitin nyo yung small letter L sa right side. Sa y-axis bending, ang gamitin mo small letter L. Sa x-axis bending, sa kaliwa, puro capital L yun. Okay? So pagka ginawa mo siyang ganun, lahat ng formula is actually lalabas WL square over 8. Except yung sa y-axis sa third points. Kasi siya WL square over 10 lang. O, mas madaling matandaan. Lahat ng formula is WL square over 8 except yung pinakadulo sa kanan na WL square over 10 lang. Again, that is in terms of small letter L sa y-axis bending. At the same time, yung pagka kinuha mo yung support reaction dun sa dalawang sag rods dito at third points, makukuha mo yun yung tension na gagamitin mo kapag ka i-design mo siya, yung tension member na sag rod. And that is equivalent to, ayan, yung tension sa sag rod would be equal to 11 over 30 WT times L. Again, yung L dun is the length of the purlin, yung full length of the purlin. 11 over 30 W tangential times capital L. Okay? So ito yung magbibigay sa atin ng mga values dito sa MUX tsaka MUY. So make sure lang that the loads that we're going to consider on this should be factored lahat. Okay? So factored load dapat siya. So yan yung magiging values natin, yung x-axis bending, ito yan. Tapos yung y-axis bending ito naman sa numerators. Okay? Then, now, so meron tayong tinatawag na mga torsional effects on the design or on design bending strength ng purlins. Okay, naalala nyo kanina, diba? Yung purlin natin, ano ba, ito yung purlin natin, tapos ito yung centroid niya. Diba yung purlin natin, yung nag-a-act lang sa centroid is yung self-weight. Tapos yung dead load, tsaka live load, tsaka wind load, lahat sila nag-a-act sa ibabaw ng purlin, diba? Okay. So kapag yung gravity loads natin, ulitin ko, kapag yung gravity loads natin ay nag-a-act dun sa ibabaw, meron siyang torsion effect na nangyayari. Okay, so ito yun yung case 2. if the loads are not applied through the shear center. Shear center, this is the point in the cross section wherein torsion is being minimized or being avoided. Ulitin ko. Kapag kayong structural load is acting at the shear center of the section, there will be no torsion occurring on the section. Okay, so tingnan natin. Halimbawa, tingnan nyo yung case 1. This is case 1. This is when the loads are applied through the shear center of the section. Okay, pagka I section, ang shear center ng I section is nasa gitna. Nasa neutral axis niya, nasa centroid niya. So, nandito yung shear center pagka I section. Samantalang pagka channel section, ang shear center niya is wala dun sa centroid. Ito yung centroid, diba? Ito yung centroid ng channel, pero ito yung shear center ng channel. So, hindi sila nagka-coincide. Okay? Ulitin ko, kapag kayong mga loads ay hindi nag-a-act sa shear center, you have to consider torsion dun sa section. Okay? So, kapag ka case 1 is kapag ka nag-a-act siya sa shear center, so ito yung equation natin, interaction equation natin. So, yung bending about X plus bending about Y, dapat yung sum nila should be less than or equal to 1 for adequacy. Otherwise, pagka na greater than 1, it will be failed. Okay? Tapos, yung case 2 natin is kapag ka naman yung structural loads natin is not applied dun sa shear center, which is the usual case. Like for example, for channel section, diba? For channel section, since ang shear center niya nandun malayo, nasa labas ng section niya, so kadalasan kapag ka channel section, hindi siya nagpa-pass through sa shear center. So eksibin, lagi nagkakaroon ng torsion. So ganun din kapag ka yung I section. Kapag ka I section nga, although ang shear center niya nandun sa gitna, diba? Pero meron kang top load. Ano ba? Itong load na to, gravity load yan eh, diba? Yung gravity load is acting at the top sa ibabaw ng purlins. So pagka na-resolve mo yan, magiging ganito siya, diba? So magiging ganyan, may vertical tsaka may horizontal component. Yung horizontal component na to, siya yung magpo-produce ng torsion. No? Siya yung magpo-produce ng torsion. So even though na wide flange section siya or I-shape siya, okay, basta yung gravity load mo is acting at the top of the flange, torsion will occur also on the section. Now, how do we analyze kapag ka sinasama na natin yung torsion? Okay, so sabi dito, torsion occurs only half of the cross section is considered to be effective with respect to its y-axis. When considering the strength of a single flange, use only half of the tabulated value of SY or ZY. So in short, kapag ka may torsion, it would be simpler to assume that the capacity on Y-axis would be reduced to half. Kaya may over to rito. Kung mapapansin nyo, yung capacity ng section with respect to Y-axis is divided by 2. Ibig sabihin, nangalahati. So yun yung effect kapag ka may torsion dun sa section. Ulitin ko, pagka may torsion dun sa section, the capacity of the section with respect to y-axis is being half, is being divided into 2. Okay, so yun lang yung mangyayari, no? So hihina siya ng kalahati sa bending about the y-axis. And the rest would be the same. The mux, the muy, the mn, and the mnx, and the mny, paano pagkuha ng mga values na yun would be just be the same. Okay, so this would be the concepts and principles that are important in the analysis and design of purlins. So in the next video, I will be showing to you examples on how to design purlins. Okay, so thank you for watching.